السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، له الملك وله الحمد، يحيي ويميت وهو على كل شيء قدير. وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله، بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة، وتركنا على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك. اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا. أما بعد، عباد الله، أوصيكم ونفسي الخاطئة بتقوى الله سبحانه وتعالى. يقول المولى عز وجل بعد أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما، صدق الله العظيم. أما بعد، brothers and sisters in Islam، أحييكم بتحية الإسلام، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. The topic of our khutbah today is actually a very important topic that touches every aspect of our daily life. Whether we are conscious to it or not as Muslims, it is about halal and haram. What is permissible in Islam, what is prohibited in Islam. And as we go in our daily life, we face this question all the time in many things we do or we get exposed to. And some of these questions are challenging because we are facing new issues all the time that requires ijtihad from ulama and requires efforts to try to see how we can apply the principles of our faith to these new issues. We actually have, if you observe the Muslim community, whether locally or globally, you find many issues. You find some people who are pious, who are taking things in a literal fashion, word for word, and they really are, in some others' opinion, pushing the envelope and asking everyone to adhere to a stricter version of Islam. You have others who totally are living life, ignoring all aspects of halal and haram. Even amongst us, who are somewhere in the middle, I hope, we face these challenging questions on a daily basis with new subjects, new things that come to under light. And one of the worst phenomena I noticed also, we are very quick to give opinions about what's halal and haram. If I ask anyone any questions about halal and haram, the chance of someone answering you by "I do not know" or "let me go back to find the answer" is near nil. Most of the time, everyone will give you a quick answer with authority, regardless to level of knowledge, which is a challenge that we face. So today, I'm actually not trying to answer questions about what is halal and what's haram, but instead share with you what I call 11 principles that guide the topic. So these principles are important principles that we all need to be aware of, and they can help us address that important topic on a daily basis. Number one, الأصل في الأشياء الإباحة. The default position in any subject, it is lawful. The default, it's lawful. So everything is lawful, and the unlawful things are the exception. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: قل من حرم زينة الله التي أخرج لعباده والطيبات من الرزق Who is giving himself the authority to prohibit what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made lawful? The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam in explicit terms says, مَا أَحَلَّ اللَّهُ فِي كِتَابِهِ فَهُوَ حَلَالٌ. Whatever Allah said is lawful in his book is lawful. وَمَا حَرَّمَ فَهُوَ حَرَامٌ. وَمَا سَكَتَ عَنْهُ. There are things that Allah did not say whether they are halal or haram. فَاقْبَلُوا مِنَ اللَّهِ عَافِيَتَهِ. Accept from Allah his graciousness. Accept from Allah his graciousness. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَمْ يَكُنْ لِيَنْسَى شَيْئًا. Allah will never forget. So Allah when ثُمَّ تَلَى قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى وَمَا كَانَ رَبُّكَ نَسِيًّا. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala leave a subject unaddressed, it is out of his mercy. And we should accept the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I give you a very practical example. In this mosque recently, a very dear brother came to me and said, he thought I am knowledgeable enough to give fatwa, which I am not, but he still came to me with a question, saying that we have a sister who is giving tafsir Quran. She's wearing, alhamdulillah, full Islamic dress code, but she give it in the musalla in front of men and women. Is this lawful or unlawful? So again, I told him, I am not a scholar to answer you, but the default position in all matters, it is lawful unless I have a proof it is unlawful. Unless whoever is complaining find in the seerah, in the Quran, a proof that this is not lawful, the default in every matter, it's lawful. That is the practicality, walhamdulillah, of our faith, the ease of our faith. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't leave anything. He said in Surah Al-An'am, وَقَدْ فَصَّلَ مَا حُرِّمَ عَلَيْكُمْ. He have detailed what is prohibited. It's not like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala left things hanging. وَالْعَيَذُ بِاللَّهِ. The second principle that we need to adhere to or listen to or understand that التحليل والتحريم حق لله وحده. To prohibit something or make something lawful, it is only the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is not the rights of people to do that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَقُولُوا لِمَنْ تَصِفُ أَلْسِنَتُكُمُ الْكَذِبُ هَذَا حَلَالٌ وَهَذَا حَرَامٌ لِتَفْتَرُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبُ إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَفْتَرُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبَ لَا يُفْلِحُونَ. Don't just with your tongue make things because of your desire or whims, lawful or unlawful, and speak on Allah's behalf, because that's a grave sin. You all know the story of Adi ibn Hatim al-Ta'i. He was a Christian who became Muslim in the later years of the Prophet ﷺ hijrah, almost 1 year before the Prophet ﷺ death. And when he came to Medina and prayed behind the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam reciting this verse describing the Christians. اتخذوا احبارهم ورهبانهم اربابا من دون الله والمسيح ابن مريم وما امروا الا ليعبدوا الها واحدا لا اله الا هو سبحانه عما يشركون. Allah is describing those people as worshipping their priests and rabbi and worshipping وَالْعَيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ Jesus, Al-Masih, while they were ordered only to worship the one God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So after the prayer, Adi ibn Hatim al-Ta'i said, Prophet of Allah, who told you that we worship our priests and rabbi? We don't worship them. What was the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam answer? إنهم أحلوا لكم الحرام وحرموا عليكم الحلال فاتبعتوهم فذلك عبادتكم إياهم. أو كما قال رسول الله. They have made the lawful unlawful. They have made the unlawful lawful and you followed them instead of following the teaching of Allah. This is how you are worshipping them. So, brother and sister, sometimes you get someone who is so attached to one sheikh. Whatever that sheikh is, says, regardless to Quran and Sunnah, goes. This is not Islam. This is not Islam. As a matter of fact, the third principle, Allah described those who do that are aggressors. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُحَرِّمُوا طَيِّبَاتِ مَا أَحَلَّ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ وَلَا تَعْتَدُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُعْتَدِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala considered it what? An act of aggression. Because you are giving yourself an authority that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not give you to do that. The fourth principle, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the all knowledgeable, the all knowing, the all wise, He knows when He says something is haram, He knows what is good for you and what's bad for you. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes something haram, it's because there is harm in that thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it unlawful. And we need to understand that and believe in that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He say, مَاذَا يَسْأَلُونَكَ مَاذَا أُحِلَّ لَهُمْ قُلْ أُحِلَّ لَكُمُ الطَّيِّبَاتِ. Allah made every good thing lawful. But bad things, for example, talk about al-khamr, alcohol and gambling. And you always hear this, yeah, one cup of wine a day give you, God knows, healthy heart. Or the lottery, and we're using the lottery money nowadays because we are funding education. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what? يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْخَمْرِ وَالْمَيْسِرِ قُلْ فِيهِمَا إِثْمٌ كَبِيرٌ وَمَنَافِعُ لِلنَّاسِ وَإِثْمُهُمَا أَكْبَرُ مِنْ نَفْعِهِمَا. Yeah, they may have some side benefits, but the harm that comes out, for example, out of alcohol with abuse is you don't know what you end up doing when you lose your mind and you can commit crimes and adultery, you don't know what to say. The harm far, far outweighs the small benefit that some may claim as a health benefit, for example. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He prohibits something, you really need to believe and understand it's for your own good, your own protection, to avoid that harm. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes something not lawful, and even you don't understand why, سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا غُفْرَانَكَ رَبَّنَا وَإِلَيْكَ الْمَصِيرُ. Maybe one day, a generation later with science will know why. But we obey because we trust that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants the best for us. And by the way, anything that is harmful with this rule applies. So for example, yeah, during Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there was no drugs, there was no marijuana, there is no bills, prescription bills abuse. But they follow the same category of harm. And because of this, the same thing apply in terms of being prohibited, even though there is no specific words for it, because it's encompassing all of this category of things. The fifth principle that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of His generosity, have given us for every unlawful thing, hundreds of options of lawful things. Example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, حرم الربا وأحل التجارة. Every aspect of merchant dealing is lawful except dealing with interest. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala حرم الزنا adultery but made marriage lawful to fulfill the needs of humans. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for men, for example, told them not to wear harir, which is silk, unless you have a medical condition. But He gave you 200 types of fabrics as options. It's not like, I don't wear silk, I die. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made alcohol haram, but gave you 200 soft drinks and milks and juices and shakes and whatnot. So the intention when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes something unlawful is what? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرَ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرَ. It is the intention of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make things easy for you, not to make it hard for you. So when Allah makes something unlawful, it's because it's really bad for you, not because Allah wants you to have hardship. And you need to believe that. In another ayah, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُبَيِّنَ لَكُمْ وَيَهْدِيَكُمْ سُنَنَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ وَيَتُوبَ عَلَيْكُمْ وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ أَنْ يُخَفِّفَ عَنْكُمْ وَخُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ ضَعِيفًا. All these ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His intention is to provide you relief, knowing the weakness of the human. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intention is to give us lessons from nations before us, so we would benefit from that and don't fall in the same mistakes. The sixth principle, whatever lead to haram is haram. So if you gonna go to a nightclub, don't tell me I'm not gonna drink, I'm not gonna look, I'm not gonna lead to something. Whatever leads to haram is haram. And you need to think of this, and you need to have the piety. And the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is by not putting yourself in a position that can lead to committing haram. So you better just from the very outset, don't put yourself in a position and test your own weakness. That is not smart. We also have a problem that is not new to the Muslim Ummah, subhanAllah. We know the nations before that, they used to do that. التحايل على الحرام حرام. You cannot fool Allah and try to work your way around what is Allah has prescribed. You all know the story of Bani Israel. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them, don't work on the Sabbath. But then he tested them with fishing. It's a village on the sea. Their main business is fishing. Every Saturday, the fish can fly in the air in front of them. They cannot touch it. Allah is testing them. The rest of the week, they cannot find any fish. So they said, okay, we're going to outsmart Allah. وَالْعَذُ بِاللَّهِ. What did they do? We'll have the nets that capture the fish on Saturday, but we'll pull it on a Sunday. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punished them severely and made an example out of them for all nations after that. We have the same attitude. I remember in this masjid, wallahi, one day after Jum'ah, a young brother, I still love him, he said, I have earned some money from gambling. I know it's haram. Can I use it to pay a traffic ticket? So people are really trying to find loopholes to do that. And it's subhanAllah, who are you fooling? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the intention in your heart. Allah knows if you are trying to do something wrong or right. So don't even try. And nowadays we fool ourselves. We call adultery affairs or whatever, lovemaking. We call interest, riba interest or whatever. And we call every other haram thing something else just to soften the name or the blow kind of. Along the same lines, the eighth principle, good intentions cannot justify the method. The Prophet ﷺ says, من جمع مالا من حرام ثم تصدق به لم يكن له فيه أجر وكان إصره عليه. Don't have a supermarket selling alcohol and come and make $100,000 donation to the masjid. Allah طيب لا يقبل إلا الطيب. Allah is pure and only accept the pure. And you will not get the reward of that, and you still get the ithm, the punishment for unlawful source of income. So good intentions, don't go rob a bank because the Muslim need a youth center. Come on. That is, people sometimes try to deceive themselves by doing these things. الله طيب لا يقبل إلا الطيب. And good intentions are not an excuse for bad approach or bad methods. The ninth principle, which please come forward so people outside can have a seat. جزاكم الله خير. The ninth principle is there is actually something called the gray zone. There is a gray zone. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, الحلال بين والحرام بين. وبين ذلك أمور متشابهات. فمن تركها استبراء لدينه وعرضه فقد سلم. ومن واقع منها شيئا يوشك أن يواقع الحرام. The Prophet says, halal is white. لما معنى? What's meaning? Haram is black, but there is something in between. Some people are aggressive. They push the envelope. And the Prophet says, those who do so are almost about to fall in haram. Now, this is a very difficult topic. And most of our differences are in that gray zone, by the way. There is few things that I need to share with you to help you in maneuver that gray zone. One is اختلاف العلماء رحمة. The difference between scholars is mercy. And even if you follow something that is more stricter than others, don't accuse the others of selling out or being, if Allah, as long as they are following a lawful school of thought. Also, if you want to take a stricter interpretation, do it for yourself, but do not do it for people. It's okay to do it for yourself, but do not do it for people. These are very important. Now, I'm going to give you a scale. Actually, not me. Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, give us a scale to deal with these gray issues. When he defined al-ithm, what is haram? What ithm is the wrong thing, the bad thing? ما حاك في الصدر. That's one. Your heart is not accepting it in clear. You are doubtful. وكرهت أن يطلع عليه الناس أو كما قال رسول الله and you feel shameful if people know about it. So if you are doing something you don't want people to know about even though it's in the gray zone and your heart is questioning it, this is definition of ithm. It's better to stay away from it. It's a personal scale that will vary from one person to another, but Sayyidina Muhammad, an Islam goal is to build the conscious. It's not the intention, it's not to have a policeman around everyone, do this and don't do this. Build that conscious. The 10th principle, whatever is haram for all. I explain. Again, the children of Israel, what did they say? لَيْسَ عَلَيْنَا فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ سَبِيلٌ. We will apply the rules, we'll treat each other nicely, lawfully. But the non-Jews are a free game. لَيْسَ عَلَيْنَا فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ سَبِيلٌ. Those who are illiterate, they are a free game. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala criticized them for saying that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to do better. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever is lawful, is lawful. Whatever is haram to do, is haram to do regardless to Muslims or non-Muslims, equal. Some people, for example, they come here in the summer from overseas. They rack up a credit card bills and then they leave without paying. That's not Islam. As an example, I'm just trying to pick some modern life examples. So, and they tell you, oh, these banks are thieves, they are charging interest, this, to justify doing that. No. Whatever is unlawful applies to every individual, Muslims and non-Muslim, at the same time. The last principle, الضرورات تبيح المحظورات. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sometime at time of desperate need or necessity, some of the unlawful things become lawful, but we need to clarify. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, for example, فَمَنِ اضْطُرَّ غَيْرَ بَاغٍ وَلَا عَادٍ فَلَا إِثْمَ عَلَيْهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. You are in the middle of a desert and you are dying and the only thing you see is a dead rabbit. You are allowed to eat some of that meat even though in other circumstances is not lawful to survive. But you do only the amount that make you survive. So مَا أُبِيحَ مِنَ الضُّرُورَةِ بِالْقَدْرِ المناسب بمعنى don't eat 10 pounds of dead meat because you want to survive. Only half a half a pound or one third of a pound because that's what it takes. Some people take that rule to an extreme, and that is wrong as well. So these are the 11 principles. If you really want to delve into this important subject, there is actually two old books that are quite helpful, especially dealing with modern issues. One is Al-Halal wal-Haram, Yusuf al-Qaradawi, Sheikh Yusuf al-Qaradawi. The other one, old book, Fiqh al-Sunnah, Sheikh Sayyid Sabiq. Also, in the U.S. here, and this is not an advertisement, this is a non-profit organization. If you Google AMJA, they are actually an organization of Muslim scholars that actually have over 10,000 fatwa on their website. And online or through phone, they can answer your question. They are resourced to you as Muslims that you may want to be aware of. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفر. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة على المصطفى. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Brothers and sisters, we actually are asked to make some dua before we start the formal dua, but it's all dua, alhamdulillah. We have Sister Nasreen Haroon, Aman Allah Hussein, Ahmed Muhammad, Liban Salat, Fatima Abu Bakr, Nabila Khadir, Haroon Hussein, who are all ill. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant them recovery, inshaAllah, speedy recovery, bi'idhnillah. We also have Brother Muhammad Kamil, who is having difficulty. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take care of his difficulties and ease his situation, inshaAllah. We also have Zikar Bangaloria, who passed away in Pakistan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shower him with his mercy and forgive his sins. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على الحبيب المصطفى سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. اللهم اجعل جمعنا هذا جمعا مرحوما وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما ولا تجعل من بيننا شقيا ولا محروما. اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات إنك سميع قريب مجيب الدعوات يا رب العالمين. اللهم رحماك بأمة عبدك ونبيك ورسولك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللهم احقن دماء المسلمين. اللهم احقن دماء المسلمين. اللهم احقن دماء المسلمين. اللهم انصر إخواننا المستضعفين في كل مكان يا رب العالمين، في سوريا وفلسطين وكل بلاد الأرض يا رب العالمين. اللهم ربنا ألف بين قلوبنا ووحد كلمتنا وولي علينا خيارنا ولا تولي علينا شرارنا، واغفر لنا وتب علينا واختم بالصالحات أعمالنا يا رب العالمين. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. وأقم الصلاة.